Perhaps it's the voice of Mother Earth that's been silenced and unheeded for too long, coming through the voices of these courageous young women who are demanding that we listen and do something. Perhaps it's the Earth's Me Too moment. We are very fortunate to have three of these leaders with us this morning. I'm going to introduce them one by one, and they'll take their seats on the stage. Alexandria Villaseñor is a 14-year-old climate activist living in New York City, frustrated by the lack of progress at the COP24 and inspired by 16-year-old Swedish climate activist Greta Thunberg. Alexandria began her own solo weekly school strike for the climate in front of the United Nations headquarters on December 14, 2018. Soon after, she became national and international organizer for the first ever Global Youth Climate Strike, which occurred on March 15, 2019. This historic strike mobilized 1.6 million youths from 123 countries to demand climate action from world leaders. For her work, Alexandria was awarded the 2019 Tribeca Film Festival's Disruptor Award. She was also awarded the Commonwealth Foundation Changemaker Scholarship, and recently she made Politico's list of top 100 people influential in climate change policy. Today, she continues her role as a prominent climate strike organizer and is working to bring accurate climate science and climate change education to K-12 schools. Please welcome her. Xiye Bastida came to the U.S. at the age of 13. She is now, I'm going to say a senior, almost, at Beacon High School and is the leader of the school's environmental club. She has worked with numerous climate organizations to communicate the implications of the existing climate crisis, among other issues. She spoke at the World Urban Forum 9 in Malaysia as the youth representative for Mexico about the challenges that youth face because of the climate crisis. In 2018, she received the Spirit of the United Nations Award for her environmental work. Please welcome Xiye. Colleen Schmidt is a writing coordinator for Columbia University Hub of the Sunrise Movement and an undergraduate studying environmental biology. Originally from Bozeman, Montana, Colleen grew up exploring western rivers and mountains, developing a deep love for landscapes and wildlife. Her appreciation for the natural world has only increased through her studies of its complexity, resilience, and interconnectedness. She is currently working on her senior thesis, a study of the relationships between nitrogen-fixing trees and the small herbaceous plants that live beneath them. Please welcome Colleen.
Busy lives, and they are indeed busy, to join us this morning. We're honored to have all of you here, and we value the important work you're doing. So first round of questions, a little bit about your background, your upbringing, when you began to realize that this was a serious problem and you became concerned, what were some of the influences that brought you to this point? And we'll start with Alexandria.
So hello, everyone, and thank you for having me here today. I'm actually a born and raised Californian. I actually moved to New York City this past August. But I was visiting family back in California around November time during Thanksgiving when the Paradise Fire broke out in my hometown of Davis, California. It's only an hour away from Paradise, so we got a lot of the smoke. It was the worst air quality in the world at one point. So for my safety, my family me back to New York City early. And at that point, I was really upset. I had a lot of family and friends still in California, and I was worried for them. And I made the connection when I came back to New York City that climate change is fueling California's wildfires, and making them have California have wildfires all year round now. I started paying attention to COP24, and when I had seen how world leaders had failed to come to an agreement to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, I had gotten really upset. So I saw Greta Thunberg speak at COP24, and I saw her call to action and how she empowered so many students to strike. So I decided to go have my own school strike for climate at the United Nations headquarters on December 14th, which was actually the last day of COP24.
And one thing leads to another, right? Okay, Xiye.
Hi everyone, my name is Xiye Bastida Patrick. I was born and raised in Mexico. I moved here 3 years ago, so the adjustment just by itself is, you know, moving at such a young age is hard. But in Mexico, I've always been surrounded by awareness of climate change issues because my parents have always fought for environmental justice. So they actually got a job here in the city with the Center for Earth Ethics with Karen Agor. And so that's why I've always been influenced by my parents. But then something happened in Mexico, so there's a lot of stories that I could tell, but I'm gonna tell this one. There's this university that they were gonna build on this land. It was just an open space, so they just went in, built the university. Halfway through, the university started to sink because the engineers, the architects, had not asked the people who lived there how the land worked. Because at a certain time of the year, it always happened every year. It would become, the earth would just become moist and, you know, heavy things just go down. So because of that, I saw that the university looks like this right now. And it's just there, and because of that, when they invited me to Malaysia to speak on behalf of youth and indigenous communities, I talked about the importance of considering indigenous perspective when you are taking action. I'm indigenous, I'm Otomi, my name Xiye means rain in Otomi. And they have this cosmology of if the earth gives you so much, you have to give back. If the earth cares for you, you have to give back. It's all about reciprocity and thinking both ways. So then that sparked my awareness, and that sparked my notion that people care about what you say. So when I went to Malaysia and I spoke at the UN once, they invited me to speak two more times at two different panels. And it was amazing for me to see that people actually cared about my experience and cared about what I had to bring to the table. So since then, I decided to speak up and tell my story. Because for me, you know, it's my story. I've been living with it my whole life. So it's not that, you know, I'm just used to it. But when I tell people, they're actually, they understand where I'm coming from and they understand the experiences that I've gone through. So in Mexico, we had a food shortage because there was a drought. And then there was heavy rains which killed all the crops. And I didn't connect that to climate change until I read about it. And that's also why I think education is so important. And then in my school's environmental club, when I joined, it was all about watching videos of nature and videos of like the ocean. And so then I thought, what is happening here? You know, there's a crisis happening. It's not only climate change, it's a climate catastrophe now. So then I decided that I was gonna change what's going on in that club. And I became leader this year of the club. And then I had a lot of speakers come over from Sunrise, from People's Climate Movement, from Extinction Rebellion, from our Children's Trust, from New York Communities for Change, and I'm part of all of these organizations. With NY Renews, we go to Albany to lobby the CCPA, the Climate and Community Protection Act. With Sunrise, I was invited to speak on March 15th for the global strike. And right now I work with People's Climate Movement, PCM, and I think it's really important to work with in an organization that represents all views, because that's the way you make the most change and you reach the most people.
Thank you. Colleen.
Hi. So I grew up in Bozeman, Montana, nearby, and from a very young age, I knew that climate change was an issue, mostly because my parents were very good about composting and recycling and talking about carbon footprint and all that kind of things. They weren't activists, but they weren't activists outside, but they were activists in their home. And so I knew I wanted to do something with my life to be useful in this movement, but I didn't know what it was going to be. I came to Columbia, to New York City, to Columbia University for college, and decided to study environmental biology because I thought that would be one way of working towards these goals. And I saw a lot of activism happening throughout growing up, and didn't really get involved because I was unsure whether the movements that were happening were holistic enough. We're talking about the impacts that climate change is going to have on people, on humans, rather than just talking about, you know, atmospheric chemistry or the abstract ideas of the science. I wasn't seeing movements that were talking about how that was actually going to affect people. Until about a year ago, when a friend of mine joined the Sunrise Movement and told me about it, was saying it's about well-being, it's about all people, it's about economic issues too, it's about figuring out how to combat climate change while also making sure that we're caring for people and all peoples. And I thought that was incredible, and of course went back to school and promptly forgot about it until I saw a video on Facebook in November of my friend from high school getting marched away from the Capitol building in DC in handcuffs. And I realized that we could actually do something and that this movement was ramping up. And so I called a couple of friends and we talked about starting the Columbia hub of the Sunrise Movement. And my friend Naomi Hollard, who was the president of that this year, really took it and ran. And she's a great speaker. And so she was able to really, she has this personality that really brought everyone together and was able to organize things like the strike on the 15th and the rally. And I've kind of gone into the background and done more of the writing, so writing letters to the editor, writing op-eds, defending our positions and things like that. So it's kind of how I got into it.
So we have background, and now you're all doing really interesting, important work in leadership. So maybe you can speak a little bit to that, give us the highlights of what you've been doing, and what direction your work has taken, expectedly or unexpectedly, over the course of these last months?
I guess over the past few months, I've become, after I started my school strike for climate in front of the United Nations headquarters, I've become a national and international organizer for the climate strike, so March 15th and May 24th, which happened this past Friday. You're in New York City, you were, there was a dine in Times Square. We had dined for 11 minutes to signify 11 years to climate change is irreversible. And besides the climate strikes, I also just announced my startup nonprofit called Earth Uprising, where it focuses on bringing climate education into schools, peer-to-peer education. Because I've learned that once students know about climate change, once they know the facts about it, then they feel more urged to get involved and go out to take direct action. So Earth Uprising is focusing on educating students to take direct action, because to get change and make our world leaders act, we need unprecedented numbers to be out there on the streets protesting. So that is what has happened in the past few months. And before I started my school strike, I wasn't really an activist. I didn't know what it was. And I just learned a lot in these past few months that I didn't expect to be passing in California.
Can you just share a little bit about some of the interesting people you've met and how they may have been influential in your thinking now that maybe you didn't have previously?
I got to meet a lot of great people through organizing. I got to meet other activists all around the world and here in New York City. I talked to activists in countries organizing like Nigeria, Australia, and that's amazing, the connections I've made with the community organized all around the world. But then I've also, the United Nations has been very supportive of my climate strategy. They've come out a couple times, they've invited me in for the eco-social forum, for just a lot of their debriefs on the United Nations Climate Summit. I've also, the UN envoy has come out to my strike, and so has Akeem Steiner, who is the head of the UNDP. So the United Nations has been very supportive. Jay Inslee has even shown his support for the climate strikes. And it's just been great to meet all these amazing people involved in climate and just bringing new people involved who have never been an activist, who've never organized for climate change, bringing them into the table and the conversation.
We saw on Twitter a picture of Jay Inslee trying to scratch out his poster, right, last week or whenever he was there.
Jay Inslee came to the UN Climate Strike about 2 weeks ago, I think. Mm-hmm. He joined me and a couple of other students who were there. And he wrote, I don't know what his sign said, but he made a sign. He had to make a sign for us. And he said he was going to put it on his wall, so I hope he's still doing that.
Thank you very much.
So I guess the most important thing I learned the past few months, or the past year, is that, so with the Green New Deal, there's a lot of national tension, I would say, because it addresses so many different topics, and it's so broad. And I'm sure you've heard about it, and maybe you're not all the way for it. But what I learned with it is that in order to achieve that change, the type of change you want, we need to hit every level of government. So we need to enact local policy, state policy, and federal policy, and of course fall under international policy, which is the Paris Climate Agreement. Although we know that the UN has no power to hold governments accountable, but we can hold our governments accountable. And my favorite chant when we strike is "We vote next," because that really scares people. If you see millions of students walking, saying "We vote next," it just like really sparks attention. They're not gonna listen to us until they know we are the ones making the decisions next. And we're just letting them know what we're gonna decide. So in New York City, we passed the Dirty Buildings Bill. We went to a couple hearings at City Hall. The Dirty Buildings Bill aims to reduce the CO2 levels from buildings, because in the city, 80% of the CO2 that's produced comes from buildings. So that reduces the emissions they can produce and makes them pay. Then at the state level, I already talked about it, the Climate and Community Protection Act. And this is particularly important for me, because it centers frontline communities, and it addresses that, you know, communities of color are the most affected. So in the Bronx, they have the highest rates of asthma because they have two like super big highways that are always polluting the air. And I don't know if you've heard about the wall that they want to build in Lower Manhattan. So that wall, it's only going to make the water go upwards. So it's going to affect Harlem, and it's going to affect Brooklyn, and it's going to affect the Bronx. And in this movement, we have to realize that it interconnects so many issues. It brings transportation, electricity, energy, labor issues too. It's so many things, and of course youth, because we are the ones who are going to be suffering the most if this doesn't get addressed now, and our children are gonna be suffering the most as well. And that's why I don't know if you've heard about the Juliana versus government lawsuit. So it's 22 plaintiffs suing the US government because of their inaction towards climate work, climate action. And they're saying, you are violating our rights because we are gonna be the ones growing up and being harmed because of climate change. But going back to the Climate and Community Protection Act in New York State, most of my advocacy work is towards passing this bill because it allocates 40% of its money towards a just transition for communities of color. And, you know, me personally, I'm from Mexico. I'm an immigrant. I'm not a citizen. I could stay at home. I could still be doing my work, doing my schoolwork, and I don't have to be involved in the politics of the climate issue. But I believe that this is an international issue, and wherever you are, you can make change, and wherever you are, you can influence people. And if I can influence people to vote for climate legislation here, I'm going to do it. And if, when I go back to Mexico in a couple weeks, I'm going to do it as well, too.
So some of the work that I've been able to do with Sunrise Columbia has been very eye-opening for me. We were talking about what do young people teach older people, what do older people learn from younger people. And of course, people look at me as a young person, but I'm 22, and that's actually pretty old for this movement. So one of the experiences that I had where I learned a lot from people younger than me was when a student from the Manhattan Country School reached out to our organization and asked if we could come in and help them write letters to the editor talking about the Green New Deal. So a few of us from Columbia went down to Manhattan Country School, and we met with 25 middle schoolers, and we sat with them, read the drafts of their letters that they'd already written, helped them finish them, helped them polish them. We even talked about some of the science. These students were very, very interested in learning not just what was going on, but why it was happening. So it was really interesting for me to be able to have the climate knowledge to talk about why greenhouse gases work the way they do, and to be talking to these eager 11, 12-year-old kids who really wanted to know why the Earth was warming so that they could tell the newspapers that they were sending their letters to why it was warming and why they were scared. So it was really eye-opening to see how young these kids were and how passionate they were already about climate change, how scared they were, what they were worried about. I talked to a 12-year-old boy who was thinking about his children already. When I was 12, I don't think I was thinking about kids at all. So it was really eye-opening for me, and I was amazed by how little I had to do with the knowledge that I had in order to help them get their voices heard. We actually had a couple people publish their letters to the editor in newspapers. So it was a really powerful experience for me there. And that's the kind of work that I'm trying to do, is just get stories out, get voices out. Because at Sunrise, we talk about how everyone has something to lose to climate change. And if we share our stories with each other, that's the best way to communicate what is at stake in this crisis.
Stories are powerful.
Stories are very powerful.
Power of the pen.
Yeah.
Or the laptop.
Or the keyboard.
Yes, the keyboard. So, closing round of questions. How do you see your future? Maybe it's very different from what you imagined when you were younger. And so just in terms of where you thought you were going in your life and where you see yourself going now. And if you have a final message for the audience or an ask, you can include that in this as well.
Well, I hope in my future I don't have to do this, because then we'll have reversed the climate crisis. But that may not happen, because youth are protesting and nothing has been changed. Not enough calls have been made. So in the future, right now, students are preparing to mobilize for direct actions, striking. There's going to be campaign in the summer of climate strike. Every week we're going to be protesting something different than needs to change in our society. So we need to keep up the momentum of the youth right now, because this is a changing point. And we are going to continue to change the conversation, because with the youth, there has been more awareness now. And we are going to be more radical, so we will make change that is going to happen. And it's very different than what I thought my life would be, because I'm still 14. So I'm in seventh grade. I didn't imagine I'd have to be fighting for my future at this age. And then I guess my last message to all of you is that most of you are adults, and what I would say to parents or adults is that you can either join the youth movement now or you can do it later. So I hope to have you all come join us.
What does your future hold?
So, you know, I always get this question, what do you want to be when you grow up? And at first it was a veterinarian, to be honest. But now I ask everyone, why do you have to grow up to be someone? You don't have to grow up to know what you want to be. And what we are is climate activists. And what we are gonna be, that depends on all of you and us when we get the chance to vote. But technically, I wanna study sustainable development and environmental policy. And I actually wanna go to Colombia, because I think that their environmental studies are very strong right now. And I know that I'm gonna keep being in the climate movement, because it's not only about enacting change, but also about holding governments accountable. So once every policy is passed and made and passed, we still need to hold them accountable, and we still need to say, just because you said you were gonna do it doesn't mean we're gonna go away. So, a closing statement for you, just to wrap it up, just know that your voice counts, and every single person has the power to create change and raise awareness.
You asked me about my future, and I'm worried, I think, like all of us are. I was talking to a friend the other day about what 10 years from now is going to look like, or 11 years from now is going to look like. And I think, I hope I won't be doing this. Like Alexandra was saying, I really hope I won't be having to keep doing this. But the next 10 years decides it, basically. A year from now, I will have graduated from college, and I'll be looking for a job. So probably something in environmental activism or environmental work like that. And then we just have to fight this fight. I would say that a lot of what I've learned from the last few months is that students and kids are scared, we're passionate, we are stubborn, and we're angry, and we're not going away. But we are still a little naive, we're still a little lacking in the experience of the world, and all of you have that experience. And if you can give a little bit of the wisdom and the knowledge that you have from living on this earth longer than us, and you can add that to this movement, we welcome it, we want it. And that's the power that we have to get this change to happen.
Just to wrap up this part, I think I just want to mention that there is a massive international climate strike being planned for September 20th, right? And that's not just a student strike, that's an everybody strike. Walk out of your job, walk out of your home, walk out of your school, and go into the streets. I think Friday in Sweden, in Copenhagen, there were 30,000 or 40,000
youth in the street for this. And how many?
10 more.
10 more. We can do that in New York City easily, right? So we need to get people out on the street. And again, I just want to thank these incredible young women, and let's heed their words today as we support them going forward.